Welcome to Inside the Taubman Approach podcast. I'm your host, Benjamin Harding. This new podcast is an inside look at the power of the Taubman Approach, an approach to working with playing-related problems such as discomfort, tension, pain, and injuries. Through firsthand experiences and discussions with some of the premier teachers of this approach, we'll be sharing how pianists at various stages of learning the piano have benefited and grown through applying the Taubman Approach. Sponsored by the Golandsky Institute. The Golandsky Institute is on a mission to provide cutting-edge instruction to pianists based on the groundbreaking work of Dorothy Taubman. If you're interested in learning more about the Taubman Approach, be sure to check out the show notes of this episode and follow links to sign up for our newsletter, to stay up to date with all that the Institute offers, including their premier subscription service that allows you to take lessons on the Taubman Approach from anywhere. Let's get into today's episode. When we speak about the Taubman Approach solving real-life problems, we are not exaggerating. In a way, because this method of work is so comprehensive, it at points seems miraculous. But with anything that is worthwhile and rooted in reality, it takes time in working with professionals for growth to take place. Our guest today, Juan José Lázaro, gets real with us in talking about how the Taubman Approach helped him and how this approach is still one of the best-kept secrets in the piano world. In order to realize the fullest benefit of this work, one must dive in and work hard over a significant period of time. But the benefits of that kind of work far outweigh the cost. Juan has an extensive background in piano playing from a young age and vast experience in the performing arts. Yet in his journey, he experienced an artistic crisis that many of us listening to this podcast have experienced. So stay tuned for a story of resilience, tenacity, and finding one's own personal path in music and with the piano. It's also a story of courage and taking time to find out what is important in life. And spoiler alert, there is a broken arm and surgery in this story. I couldn't believe it when I heard it. You've got to hear it. Stay tuned for this episode. Let's get into it. Thank you so much for joining us today on the Golandsky Institute podcast.
Oh, my pleasure.
Tell the audience a little bit about your background as a pianist.
Well, I pretty much grew up playing the piano. I started when I was four or five, I believe. And as time went on, it simply grew with me. I had a wonderful private teacher, then went to Manus Pre-College, went to LaGuardia High School, and did my bachelor's at Juilliard. Then after a sort of artistic crisis that everybody, I guess every musician goes through, I took some time off, studied with Miss Golandsky, who's now my private teacher, for many years, and decided to go into the field of opera as a collaborative pianist. And I'm currently on my second year at the Lindemann program at the Metropolitan Opera, their young artist program.
Incredible. Incredible. Wow. And you mentioned an artistic crisis. If you're listening to this podcast, you're probably not unfamiliar with an artistic crisis at some point in your journey. And so tell the audience about sort of what kinds of questions were coming into your mind as you were kind of going through that particular part of the artistic journey.
Well, I was dealing with limitations in my playing, and I felt like I didn't know what I was doing. How would I live as a musician? What was more fulfilling to me? And those were the kinds of questions that came up.
Indeed. And those are the questions that
I think for us as sort of circumspect artists, we ask at numerous times in our life. And were you experiencing any kind of pain at all in your playing or any kind of discomfort?
Oh, yes. Yes. During Juilliard, I had quite a few problems when I was playing. It wasn't related to speed or it had more to do with when I wanted to do more things musically, become finer, more refined, do things more with tone. I would start to get extremely tight in my back. Really? I'd get pain in my right hand. I'd get pain in my hand. So I knew that at some point when I was going to graduate Juilliard that I was going in the wrong direction. I was just,
yeah, so you were trying to express yourself and express what the composer was intending and experiencing limitations. And you wanted to go deeper into the music, but you were experiencing pain and tightness and
yes.
And, wow. So what led you to, pursue Edna Golandsky? How did you hear about her and her work? What was that like?
Well, Taubman at Juilliard is known somewhat because some of the teachers there had studied with her at some point in their lives. And I wasn't too sure. And Edna Golandsky's videos always circulated around.
Right.
So I found her through there. I actually went back and forth. I always just jokingly tell Edna I always apologize for being such a brat because I believe I had two lessons with her, and then I wasn't too sure, and then I met Yosu de Solaun, who's a wonderful pianist.
He was a few lessons with him.
And I had several conversations with him, and I realized that that was the direction that I needed to go. So then I fully committed, actually.
Yeah, Yosu, I love Yosu. We were classmates together at Manhattan School. So
okay.
Yeah, just an amazing person, an amazing pianist, and surely a beneficiary of the Taubman approach. And so you went to Yosu, and then you started thinking, wow, I should probably go back to Edna.
No, I saw what could be done if I took the time off. Because that was the big thing. Like, do I take the time off to essentially relearn?
Wow. Yeah.
Relearn. That is what I had to do in order to get past the discomfort, the pain. It was, for me, it was not a quick fix.
Yeah.
It was not a quick fix. It was a relearning that paid off, really paid off.
That is very courageous of you.
I took two years off. I mean, I was lucky my father understood what I needed to do in order to like stay in this field.
Yeah.
Because I told my parents, like, I simply can't play like this. I'm just uncomfortable all the time. I cannot practice. I can't. So I essentially took a year off and then another year to go in another direction in terms of like career.
Wow. I mean, that is, I just have to commend you for that. And I know the audience will certainly feel the way I do. That is a courageous act for your art to say, wow, I need to pause. I need to relearn some things. And now you're thriving. It sounds like you're thriving. It sounds like you're on a path of fulfillment in your artistry.
Yes. Because I can now play my instrument. I am doing what I learned how to do. I am, thanks to Edna's work, thanks to the work I've done with her musically, technically, I don't feel like I'm starting every piece as if I haven't played the piano.
Amazing.
I can really apply what I learned from previous teachers, what I learned from all the musical education I received, and the kind of sound world I like.
Yeah, indeed. Indeed. And so, you know, as you think through your journey in the Taubman approach with Edna, if someone was nervous or doubtful that the Taubman approach might work for them, what would you say to them to encourage them to try it?
To encourage them to try it, I would say go for it. I would say go for it, but to have them understand that everybody's journey is a different one.
Yeah.
Some people, but there, that everybody's journey, how fast you, I can't gauge how fast a person will absorb the information and be able to apply it. Yeah, it's different for everybody, but the results are fruitful.
Yeah.
That's what I can say there. If you put the time into it, if you really want to learn what movements make up musical and aligned playing, I guess. This is as advanced as it gets.
Yeah.
And I've tested Edna's the Taubman approach in very extreme situations. I don't know if I commented that before when I was doing my auditions for the Lindemann program, I was a week away from getting arm surgery because of a fracture, because of a badly operated fracture that I had done.
Oh my goodness.
Yes. So it was thanks to what I learned from Edna that I was able to do the audition and get through, because I had a fracture of my left arm, the upper arm. And it was operated on in an emergency surgery in another country, and it was done badly.
Oh my goodness!
So before I was set to have my audition, I believe in like late March, and April. I believe it was April 1st that I had to have the operation, because it was bad. The metal was moving, the arm wasn't stable, but. I have to say, thanks to the use of the forearm.
Yeah.
And I basically used only the movements that were necessary for playing. It wasn't fun, but I did a very good audition thanks to that. It was thanks to knowing what I was doing that I was able to overcome very severe limitations. That had I not done this work, I would not have done that audition.
Well, that is phenomenal.
So I really, I'm not out of choice, but I really have tested a lot of what Taubman teaches in very extreme situations.
Yeah, that's wow. That's an extreme testing case.
Yeah, no. I and also the recovery was. At least I was once I was free of the cast and was given the all clear to move, the recovery of the movements of my hand weren't complicated at all.
Amazing.
I was told to go to like a physical therapy and regain strength in the hand, and I didn't do any of that, at least for my hands. I didn't have to. Playing essentially was the recovery.
Amazing. So prior to studying with Edna, what was your sort of technical approach? If you could sort of fundamentally boil it down for the audience.
I was actually lucky in that that's not a fast question, because I was lucky in pre-college to have a very intuitive teacher from, I believe, former Soviet Union, from Ukraine. And from Ukraine, and my time in pre-college was actually a good one, because she did not believe in a very high finger approach.
Okay.
It was not a very isolated approach. I always remember her saying, "You, sweetie, stand on your finger, stand on your finger, stand on your finger." Like, yes, because I asked her about these things. She said, well, I went to a doctor and she said that the fingers don't work that way. They don't work like this in this up and down way. So I did not have, I had some limitations, but I didn't have any problems in pre-college. It was only when I went to conservatory and I had to essentially compete with other musicians that I wanted to do more. I wanted to be more creative, more to control of my tone, that I started going in I hit a wall.
Yeah.
And I was going in the wrong, direction.
Yeah.
So it was, and in Edna, I found somebody who I felt close to musically. I understood her musically. I liked her approach to sound. It clicked very well between us.
Oh, that's fantastic. And so how have you seen problems being solved in your own teaching through the Taubman approach as you kind of pass on your experience with it to your students?
Oh, I'm actually not a piano teacher.
Oh, okay.
I'm not a piano teacher. I am. That's not. I just, to me, it feels like too big of a responsibility. That's why it feels like I think about it often, because I feel like, for example, if I were to teach a child, like Miss Moran, I believe her name is, she has that talent for that. Like, I just feel it to be such a responsibility because I would have to place their hands correctly, teach the first movements. It's very stressful for me. I still haven't passed that bridge.
Yeah, no problem. But maybe in your vocal coaching, how has that sort of impacted how you've envisioned the voice and how you encourage these singers?
Yes. I've actually sent several of my colleagues to Edna when I can. I've sent colleagues to Edna. I've sent my pianist friends to Edna. And it reaffirms my belief in a more systematic approach to things.
Yeah,
it's reinforced that, like, yes, there's creativity. Yes, there's imagination, but there is always a base to things.
Yeah.
There are always principles that one follows to make one's life easier.
Indeed.
And like you shouldn't have to reinvent the wheel with every piece.
Indeed. Indeed. So, thank you. Thank you for sharing your story. Where can people get in touch with you to hear more about your work, your artistry, but also maybe the Taubman approach if they have questions? Do you have a website? Do you have social media? Where can we find you?
I do have social media. My website's under construction right now.
Indeed.
So it's non-existent. It's in its first stages. I have Instagram, I believe. Oh my God. I think I'm going to have to leave a link for that one.
No problem.
And you can find me under my name, I believe.
Yeah, indeed. And I'll put this in the show notes for our audience so you can be in touch with Juan and just experience his tremendous, tremendous journey in so many ways, musically, psychologically, physically, as he's taking on the Taubman approach in this prestigious program that you audition with a broken upper arm. I mean, this is unbelievable to me that you took that audition. Well, all the best to you. And thank you so much for joining us today on the Golandsky Institute podcast.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you so much.